Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and this is my favorite topic when talking skeletal muscle cells. And this is the composition of the structures within the cells. And it's really through these structures that you can actually begin to understand how muscles are able to contract. So you have to have all of these small scale structures working in order to get the larger scale contraction that you can actually see and that will cause the movements that we can observe. Now, as mentioned in another video, muscle cells go by some other names. Now, I personally like the name muscle fiber, which is indicative of the relatively long size of a muscle cell. You may also hear the term myofiber. So all three of these terms, muscle cells, muscle fibers, and myofibers, mean the same thing. And as you can see in this illustration, there is a lot going on within a muscle cell. There's a lot of structures within. So let's talk about some of these structures in a bit more detail. Most of the structures within a muscle cell have slight variations to their name to indicate they are part of a muscle cell. So if you see this sarc, this means flesh, and you will see this prefix affixed to many of these muscle cellular structures. The second part of this name, lemma, means sheath, with the sarcolemma basically forming a sheath around the muscle cell, so it will go around the entirety of the muscle cell. This one's kind of showing you what's going on deep here, but just think of, in essence, the sarcolemma is the plasma membrane of the muscle cell. Alright, so in certain areas of the sarcolemma, it will invaginate or kind of tunnel its way deep in from the surface toward the center of the muscle. And you can see that right here as well. These invaginations are called transverse or T-tubules. And this allows, these structures will allow the muscle action potential to propagate or spread widely and quickly throughout the muscle fiber. So not only, say if you have an action potential running along the sarcolemma, not only will it get the superficial portion, but it will head down towards through these T-tubules to the deeper portions of the cell as well. Note that these T-tubules are very closely related to the sarcoplasmic reticulum. So, a bit about the sarcoplasmic reticulum, or the SR. These are going to be fluid-filled membranous sacs that are going to encircle myofibrils. Myofibrils are different from the myofiber. Myofiber, recall, is the whole cell. A myofibril is going to be the smaller contractile structures within the sarcoplasm. The sarcoplasmic reticulum is similar to the smooth endoplasmic reticulum in non-muscle cells. And this is kind of a key here. The key to the function of the SR, or part of the function, is that it stores calcium in a relaxed muscle. Alright, so note that I said relaxed here, and then I'm underlining it. So it's in a relaxed muscle that the calcium will stay. Now, at the ends of the sarcoplasmic reticulum, there'll be these dilations, which you can see here and here, here and here, on these images. And these dilations of the SR are called terminal cisterns, or cisternae if you're talking plural. And these will butt up against the T-tubules, so they'll be right next to the T-tubules of the sarcolemma. And when you combine the two cisterns, so here is a cistern, here is a cistern, here's a T-tubule. When you have those three together, that's referred to as a triad. And when an action potential travels down that T-tubule from the sarcolemma, it will trigger the release of calcium. It will trigger the release of calcium from those terminal cisterns of the sarcoplasmic reticulum into the sarcoplasm. And it's that calcium release that is vital in allowing muscle contraction to occur. Now, the sarcoplasm, like I said, there will be release of calcium into the sarcoplasm. The sarcoplasm is basically just the cytoplasm of a skeletal muscle cell, and it's surrounded by the sarcolemma. There is a lot going on in the sarcoplasm, some of which we've already discussed, like the SR. The bulk of the sarcoplasm, there's going to be quite a bit of these small thread-like, that's what this is, and you're seeing this one's kind of pulled out right here. These thread-like structures called the myofibril. All right, so the myofibril. And this is a close-up of myofibril. Microscopically, this is what the sarcoplasm looks stuffed with. And we'll come back to the myofibrils in the next slide and talk a little bit more about its composition. But that's what looks like is making up the bulk of the muscle cell. There are obviously going to be mitochondria, like most other cells, associated with the muscle cell. And there is something also called myoglobin, which these are red-colored proteins only found in muscle, and you have that myo in there that's kind of leading you to that. These proteins bind oxygen molecules that diffuse into the muscle fibers from the interstitial fluid, and this oxygen, so it's binding to the myoglobin, and it can be released from the myoglobin when needed by the mitochondria for ATP production. The sarcoplasm also has a substantial amount of glycogen, which is a molecule that stores linked glucose molecules that can be broken down when needed to produce ATP. And ATP keeps coming up here over and over again, right? So ATP is something that's very important in terms of muscle contraction. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate. Don't worry so much about the full name. But this is an organic compound that plays a role in an energy transfer and is vital to allowing muscle contraction to occur, as well as you need ATP to actually stop muscle contraction. So it's needed for both processes. Also, sustained contractions, you'll need more ATP. So muscle cells need to be able to create or synthesize ATP, so a lot of the structures within can be broken down or allow for oxygen to be released and for the ATP production. So it makes sense. You have to have lots of structures that play a role in terms of creating ATP. Okay, returning to myofibrils. These are going to be the contractile elements of the muscle cell. And one myofibril is going to extend the entire length of the muscle fiber or the muscle cell. And these have very prominent striations, and it is these that really give that very prominent striped appearance, of a muscle cell. So that's what it's kind of giving you this in here. And we'll talk about what's actually composing these myofibrils in a moment. Specifically, myofilaments. All right. Myofilaments are going to make up the myofibrils for the most part, and these are proteins, and there are three major types associated with a muscle cell. There are contractile proteins, which will generate the force during contraction. There are regulatory proteins, which help kind of switch on and off the contraction process. And lastly, there are structural proteins that keep structures in place and in proper alignment, as well as linking the myofibrils to the sarcolemma, and also play a very important role in terms of the overall extensibility and elasticity of the muscles. And when you put these all together, when you put these proteins all together, you will have a myofibril. So the smaller myofilaments do not extend the entire length of a muscle cell, but the myofibril does. So myofibril is larger, the myofilaments make up the myofibrils. So let's talk a little bit about the different types of proteins, starting with the contractile proteins. There are two major types of contractile proteins. They'll be actin and myosin, and what these proteins do will really be to convert ATP's chemical energy into the actual mechanical energy of motion. So these are what's going to lead to the sliding that occurs with these filaments. Myosin is the main component of the thick filament, that's really what I meant to put here. So each of these myosin muscles, as you can see here, are kind of shaped like two golf clubs that are all twisted together towards the back, and then you'll have the prominent myosin heads. I meant to put filament. They are proteins, and that's very true, but when you kind of combine a bunch of myosin together and some other structures, you have thick filament. And same thing here, this should say filament. So actin is the main protein in thin filament, and there are two thin filaments for every thick filament. And these thin filaments will overlap with the thick filament during the various phases of muscle contraction. Also, on each of the actin proteins, there will be what's referred to as myosin binding sites, where a myosin head can attach during the contraction process, and it'll just kind of move down the line during the contraction process. Also part of the thin filament are the regulatory proteins, which, as I mentioned previously, will play a role in terms of switching the contraction process on and off. So in a relaxed muscle, or a muscle that's not contracting, myosin is blocked from the myosin binding sites on actin, because tropomyosin is kind of sitting and blocking those sites. So you can see the myosin binding sites right here, and you see that the tropomyosin is just sitting right on top of those, not allowing myosin to be able to attach to the actin. Also note that troponin, which you can see kind of illustrated right here, is attached to the tropomyosin, keeping tropomyosin in its place. But when a calcium ion actually binds to troponin, say after the release from a terminal cistern of the sarcoplasmic reticulum due to an action potential, that troponin will actually kind of move, will actually undergo a change in shape. So this part will undergo a change in shape, which will allow for the tropomyosin to move some and move away from those myosin binding sites on the actin, allowing for myosin to bind. And this is where muscle contractions can really begin. So the organization of these structures are into basic functional units called sarcomeres, and there's that sarc again. On each end of a sarcomere, you will have what is called a Z-disc. I'm just going to outline these Z-discs in red here. And Z-discs are plate-like regions of protein to which the thin filament is attached. So you can say a sarcomere extends from one Z-disc to the next. So this, as you can see here, is considered a sarcomere. And how much overlap there is between the thin filament and the thick filament. So this would be the thin right here, and this larger portion would be the thick. And how much overlap there is between the thin and the thick will really depend on whether the muscle is relaxed or stretched or contracted. Now, don't worry about these things right here, or this M line right here. H-zones and A-bands and I-bands, they're super cool, but we're getting super into physiology and histology there, so we aren't going to dive quite that deep for this course. For our purposes, I will be happy if you understand that skeletal muscle can shorten during contraction because that thick and the thin filament slide past one another. So you can see here in a more relaxed muscle that the thin filament right here is not completely overlapping with the thick right here. But with muscle contraction, you can see that the thin filament will overlap completely with the thick filament. And that will cause for the muscles to contract. So it's not the myofilaments that are shortening. You can see that this is the same size as this, It just has everything to do with how much overlap there is. So myofilaments slide, and that will cause the sarcomere to shorten. And those sarcomere, a linkage of sarcomeres will shorten in a row, leading to shortening of the whole muscle. Before we move away from this topic, I do want to mention a few of the structural proteins, but certainly not all of them. There are a lot of structural proteins, and they play a multitude of roles, some mentioned right here. And we will start with the big one, titin or titin. You'll hear it either way. This is going to be the third most plentiful protein in skeletal muscle, just behind actin and myosin. And it's named titin or titin based on its super large size, its relatively huge size, particularly in comparison to the other proteins in this area. These are going to be particularly important in terms of stabilizing the thick filament. So you can see it having an attachment with the thick filament and the Z disc right here. This protein can also stretch and bounce back really well undamaged, so it will account for much of the elasticity and extensibility of muscles. Next, we have nebulin, which helps in thin filament stabilization. So titin was more important in terms of thick filament. Nebulin's more important in terms of thin filament. And actually wrap around the entirety of the thin filament and anchor to the Z disc. And lastly for our discussion are the dystrophin proteins, which will link the thin filament to proteins in the sarcolemma. So many suggest that it really helps to transmit tension generated by sarcomeres to tendons and also plays a very important role in terms of reinforcing the sarcolemma. In individuals with Duchenne muscular dystrophy, the gene that codes for dystrophin is mutated, which will lead to little to no dystrophin being produced. And without that reinforcement that comes from the presence of dystrophin, the sarcolemma is more likely to tear during muscle contractions, and that can lead to slow and eventual muscle rupture and death. All right. That was a lot of information in this particular video, but a lot of really important information that leads to a better understanding of how muscles contract. So let's go over a concept together before we move to the next video. So the question is, which structure of a myofiber stores calcium in a relaxed muscle? In a relaxed muscle. All right, is it actin, dystrophin, sarcolemma, sarcoplasm, or sarcoplasmic reticulum? So pause the video. I really want you to get this one because this is an important concept. And when you're ready to go, let's talk a little bit about this stem. So this is a structure of a myofiber. Well, all of these structures are going to be within a myofiber, so not all that helpful. Storing calcium. Okay, that's important. Really, only two of these may have calcium associated with it to a bigger extent, and that would be this one, the sarcoplasmum and the sarcoplasmic reticulum. But this term stores is kind of key here, because really only the sarcoplasmic reticulum is going to store calcium, and really what kind of just totally clues you in and hopefully leads you to the right answer is that it is going to be in a relaxed muscle. So we know that E, sarcoplasmic reticulum, is correct. Calcium can certainly move into the sarcoplasm, particularly once released from the sarcoplasmic reticulum, that can lead to contraction, but it's really that SR that's going to store the calcium in a relaxed muscle. All right, so this was quite a bit, and I hope you have time to kind of review this and find those areas that you still have questions on or you just need some more clarification, and you can always feel free to reach out to me with any of those questions. Thank you for your time and attention here, and have a great rest of your day.